How's everybody doing? All right, good. I'm still dealing with getting everything set up here because they don't have me set up, so excuse me while I fix the computer the way it should be fixed. Otherwise, I'm going to see it, and you're not going to see it, and that wouldn't be good. Everybody had a good summer?
Yeah.
Up until today? This is a very rehearsed group. There we go. All right, now everybody's got it. So, welcome to BB450. My name is Kevin Ahern, and I will be your instructor this term. And I will tell you that teaching BB450 is one of the funnest things I do the whole year. It's a real kick for me. I truly enjoy big classes. I know a lot of people don't like big classes, but I really like big classes. And big classes do take a lot of time. They do take a lot of energy. And much as I would like to get to know every one of you personally, I probably won't. But that shouldn't stop you from coming to see me. The students who come to see me, I do get to know very well. And the only limitation in me getting to know you then is whether or not you come to see me. If you're sitting in the back row back there, I'm not going to come to see you. But if you come to my office, I'm happy to meet with you. Okay? So coming to see me and that interaction that I can have with you allows me to help you to better understand the subject of biochemistry. All right? How many people in here are worried about biochemistry? Oh, boy. Okay, yeah. Anxiety's out there, right? I think one of the worst things that we do is needlessly obsess with worrying. And as a consequence of that worrying, what we do is we put ourselves on a path to not be successful. All right? So your anxieties really get in the way of your success. Is one of the most common things I hear from students is, wow, it really wasn't what I had heard. And of course, I always take that in a positive sense, right? That it wasn't something that was impossible to do. It wasn't something that was like organic chemistry. It was something that was relevant to my major, and it was something that I could understand. The limitation between you and understanding is frequently you, all right? You will listen to me, and when I meet with you one-on-one, I will tell you over and over the power of positive thinking. I really believe in this. And more importantly, I believe in the very negative power of negative thinking. The more you tell yourself something is going to be tough, the more likely it's going to seem tough, because your body listens to you. Nobody else listens to you, but your body listens to you. Okay? So it's important for you to be telling your body the right stuff. All right? So forget what you thought about it before now. Forget what somebody's told you before now. All right? The time for you to be successful is right now, and I want you to have that. All right. Now, let me say a little bit about the class and a little bit about how I do things, and then we'll dive into the subject. So the class is, as you see it here, this is the schedule page. And if you note the URL up there, I sent this to you in an email. But if you registered late, you might not already have that URL. This is where essentially everything's going to happen. Okay? Somebody asked before the class started, where's the syllabus? All right? Well, the syllabus is online. I'm not going to print out. There are 400 of you. I'm not going to print out 400 syllabuses and waste paper when we could do it online. That doesn't mean the syllabus is not important. The syllabus is important because there will be at least one question on your first exam straight from the syllabus. You are responsible for knowing what's in the syllabus. Okay? If you ask questions that are answered in the syllabus, you will lose points. It pays to read the syllabus, right? Because I go to a lot of time and effort to put information in that syllabus that's relevant for you. If I'm wasting my time, that's not good, right? So it's important for you to read the syllabus, all right? You see a camera sitting here. I videotape all of my lectures, all right? And I do that not so that you can sleep in and not go to biochem class at noon, all right? But rather, to help you have an additional way of getting information. Maybe you had to go to a funeral. Maybe you couldn't make it to class that day, and maybe that videotape may help you out. Maybe English is not your first language, and maybe listening to it multiple times may help you to learn the subject. Or maybe I'm just one confusing guy, and listening to it more than once really helps. Whatever the reason, those videotapes are there to help you. Okay? My rule with students is I will continue to videotape as long as people use the videotaping for the right sense. When I videotape and I see the class attendance down to, oh, let's say 50% of normal, then it tells me that people aren't using the videotapes for the right reason. You get my drift? The drift is come to class. Okay? Come to class. Use the videotapes as your backup, but come to class. I expect to see you here. You guys are in a 400-level class. That's not surprising. All right? Now, a 400-level class is just that. It is a challenging class. If you come to this class expecting it's going to be like a 100 or a 200 or even a 300-level class, you're going to get a surprise. There's a lot of stuff that's here. And you'll see that I do talk fast. And you'll see also that I'm a pacer. You're already seeing that. Your eyes are going, I'm tired of following him back and forth and back and forth. Okay? When you watch the videotapes, speed it up to about 4 times. It's really fun. Okay? Okay. Now, the way I do is, I put the lectures up here on video, the videotape lectures. Those typically go up about within the 24 hours or so of me videotaping them. There are occasionally electronic snafus, so I can't guarantee that every single one makes it up there. Okay? But whenever they're available, I put them up there. At the end of each lecture, I put together highlights that summarize what I thought were the most important things that I recalled talking about in class. Okay? Those highlights are there to help you to focus. When I go to write exams, guess what I look at to remind me what to ask about? The highlights. My deal with you, and students always ask this question, so I'm going to answer it before we even get started. My deal with you is that I will not ask you about anything I don't talk about in class. You may find things in the book that I don't talk about in class. You may find things on the internet that I don't talk about in class. Okay? But everything that you're responsible for is what I talk about in class. So I'm not going to go back out and pick out some esoteric questions about something that I haven't talked about in class. So talking about it in class is critical, and that's why the highlights help you to focus on what I've talked about. Make sense? Okay. There are some problems that are here. You all have to go to recitation. Recitations are required. They're a part of your grade. Attendance is taken. Okay, so you need to go to recitations because we pay a lot to teaching assistants to lead recitations because we know that having you have someone help you to work problems helps you to do better. Okay? So it's really, really critical that you take advantage of what we offer you there. Okay? There are no problems to turn in during the recitations. Some of you had recitation already today, and you saw what we do. One of the things we do is that in the recitations, you're going to analyze figures that come from the class. Sometimes you will have seen those figures already. In many cases, you will not have seen the figures at all. And so we want to know, what are you seeing in these figures? Are the figures good? Are the figures bad? Can the figures be improved? I'm in the process right now of writing a brand new biochemistry textbook. Okay? Many of you have already probably downloaded the free biochem textbook. How many people have downloaded the free biochemistry free and easy? Okay. So I'm writing one. The free and easy was not designed for this course. That's why it's not the required text for the course. But I'm actually writing one right now that will be the required text for this course when it's completed. Too late for you guys. It'll be free, like that one was. Okay. So the more feedback and input I have from you in terms of what you understand in figures really helps me in designing figures for this new textbook. Okay. Important things. All right. Questions about what I've said so far? Am I that clear or are you that sleepy? Okay. Well, one of the things I love to do is I love to write songs and I love to write limericks, all right? And so I thought it might be fun if every lecture we had a limerick. So I decided to make some here, okay? So here's a limerick. All the knights of King Arthur have found, when they go to the pub in the town, most to attend will overextend, but circumference just gets around. Okay, thank you. So I'll try to post one of those for each lecture, and you can have something to laugh at. Okay. I'm on Facebook. I love Facebook friends. Send me a Facebook friend. I'll be happy to be your friend. And that's another way to stay in touch. Somebody laughing at that? Okay. That's it. I think I'm ready to get started. Any comments or questions? Okay. Well, we start our discussion of biochemistry. Oh, by the way, I do forget one thing. I asked the teaching assistants to come today so you have a chance to see them, and all but one I think were able to make it. So can I ask the teaching assistants to stand, and so everybody has a chance to see them. This is Dimitri. Okay, Dimitri here. Back there is Michelle, Josiah, Andrew, and Rachel. And so you will get to know them during this term. Like I keep office hours, so they keep office hours as well. And I'll have those office hours posted later this week, so you'll see when you can meet with them and where you can meet with them. If you're looking for office hours with me, I don't post office hours. I post my schedule, and you have access to my schedule. Whenever I'm not in a meeting, I'm basically in my office and available. So I'm there a lot. You don't need to be shy. You don't need to worry about can I schedule this meeting or not. If you want to schedule a meeting, we can, but you don't need to do that. Come and see me. I'll be happy to meet with you and help answer your questions. Okay. Well, let's talk about the most important thing that's at the root of all living systems that we know of on the face of the earth, and that's water. Okay. We all know that we're 75% water. We hear that all the time. You know that water is critical for understanding basic chemistry, solution chemistry. And we worry about water because everything that we do is ultimately governed by the properties of water. We're going to hear this over and over during the term. Okay? So it's essential that we all start in the right place. And one of the things I'm going to start off in talking to you about, okay, is understanding chemistry and mathematics in very, what I call, practical senses. Practical. Well, if I have a practical sense of this, what is an impractical sense of something? Okay. An impractical sense of something is something that you perhaps memorized that you didn't really understand what it meant. Or perhaps mathematically that you punched into a calculator that you never thought about. By the way, just to put the fear in everybody, you don't get to use a calculator in this class. And no, you don't have to memorize what the logarithm of 4 is, okay? I will set problems up so that you won't need a calculator. Because the practical knowledge you will have of mathematics and the practical knowledge that you will have of chemistry will mean that you won't need one. Okay? That's important. Practical things are things that you can use. And that's how I want you to view your chemistry. And that's how I want you to view your math, and ultimately, that's how I want you to view your biochemistry. Okay. Well, let's see. Where should we start? Let's start talking about charges and interactions. Okay? Charges and interactions. As we're going to see going through this subject, charges and interactions are the absolute be-all, end-all in biochemistry. Everything that happens at the molecular basis of life, and yes, biochemistry is the molecular basis of life, everything that happens at the molecular level happens as a result of charges and interactions. Charges may dictate the interactions. Partial charges, we will see, are very important for interactions. The most common partial charge that we talk about is a hydrogen bond. Impractically, when you learn chemistry, you probably learn that hydrogen bonds are things that form in water. Does that do you much good? Probably not. Practical knowledge tells you that those hydrogen bonds give water the properties that it has, and those hydrogen bonds are not unique to water. In fact, they are present in biomolecules like proteins, like DNA. And because these molecules are full of hydrogen bonds, they have some magnificent properties. What is a hydrogen bond? A hydrogen bond arises as a result of unequal sharing of electrons. By virtue of its name, a hydrogen bond will always involve hydrogen. Okay? It will always involve hydrogen. Well, hydrogen, of course, is one of the seven or eight atoms that we talk about that are found in every single living system that's around. Oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur, carbon, etc. Okay? Proteins are made up of amino acids. We'll talk about proteins in a lot of depth coming up very soon. And amino acids, if you remember from your organic chemistry, amine means NH something, right? So when we have nitrogens and we have hydrogens, nitrogens do not have the same affinity for electrons as hydrogen does. Nitrogen has a greater affinity for electrons than hydrogen does. So therefore, nitrogen will pull electrons closer to it than hydrogen will when they're in a covalent bond. Meaning, nitrogen will be slightly more negative. That's that little delta sign there that you see right here. And hydrogen will be slightly positive because it's partly given that up. Now, notice we say partial. It's really a proximity. It has nothing to do with an ionic bond in which the electron is given up. Sodium chloride makes ionic bonds because chloride grabs the electron and sodium gives it away. Covalent bonds, that doesn't happen. They're sharing electrons, but it's like the big sibling and the younger sibling, where the big sibling is kind of holding a little closer because it's my lunch money, it's not yours. Right? Okay. Oxygen, same property. Oxygen has a greater affinity. And by the way, the affinity for electrons you should have learned in freshman chemistry was electronegativity. Electronegativity is a measure of the affinity for electrons. Well, if we have something that's partially negatively charged and the hydrogen is partially positively charged, that partial positive charge is going to be attracted to something that's positive, partially negatively charged. And looky there. There's an interaction. You see those little green dashes there. Those green dashes are there to indicate an attraction. Okay? Plus attracts minus. These attractions, each one is very, very tiny. But add them up and they can be significant. It's because of these attractions that DNA has a double helix. And that double helix is very stable. But if we look at the interaction between one base and another base, that's not enough to hold it together. It's the sum of the hydrogen bonds that holds the double helix together. Okay? The fact that they're weak, they're much weaker than a covalent bond. The bond between this nitrogen and this hydrogen is much stronger than the bond, this hydrogen bond between this hydrogen and this nitrogen on the right. Okay? Covalent bonds are much stronger than hydrogen bonds. The weakness of the hydrogen bonds turns out to be an incredibly wonderful thing in biochemistry. An incredibly wonderful thing. We'll see how that plays out. Okay? All right. Here are some biomolecules illustrating that. Here's a water. We know that most of the stuff that we have in our body is dissolved in water. The cytoplasm of our cells contains water. We are 75% water. So biomolecules like proteins, like DNA, like RNA, like metabolites, like a variety of things, have to be soluble in water. And the way that they get soluble in water, two things. Ionizing and hydrogen bonds. Those two things are why substances are soluble in water. Here is a prime example. Here is a carbonyl group that we might see in a protein. It's interacting with this hydrogen. Look, notice the little green dashes there. The green dashes indicating a hydrogen bond between this partially negatively charged oxygen and this partially positively charged hydrogen. Water literally pulls these things into solution. That's what's happening when hydrogen bonds form. Okay? We can see hydrogen bonds happening with water. We can see hydrogen bonds happening between the groups themselves. Here's one part of a protein. Here's another part of the protein. And they're interacting. And those interactions between those different parts of the protein, as we will see, were really, really critical to giving proteins their three-dimensional structure. You're going to get tired of me telling you that phrase, three-dimensional structure. Because the three-dimensional structure of a protein is what gives a protein every property that it has. Every property that it has. We will talk later about several forces that stabilize protein structure. One of those forces is a hydrogen bond. Okay. We'll dive in off the deep end here. Okay. Now I'm just going to show you this briefly. If you don't understand what I talk about here, don't sweat. It's the first day of class. Okay. And no, it doesn't go off worse because, oh my God, if that's what we talked about on the first day of class, we're really going to be stuck now, right? Okay. Oil and water don't mix, right? You put some vinegar together with some oil, makes a great salad dressing. However, you get layers. The oil on top, the water, the vinegar, which contains the water down below. Okay? Why don't they mix? They don't mix because there's not enough hydrogen bonds that form between the oil and the water. If there were, the oil would dissolve. How many people know what entropy is? I should say, how many people think they know what entropy is? Okay. You guys know what entropy is. It's disorder. We talk about it as chaos, right? It's mixed upness. If I take a deck of cards and it's all ordered, ace, king, queen, jack, etc., and I shuffle it, it doesn't stay that way. It mixes up. That's entropy, okay? What you see on the screen is actually entropy. As I said, if you don't understand it, which I'm going to tell you in a second, if you don't understand it, don't sweat. We'll talk more about it later. But entropy is what causes proteins to do a phenomenon that we describe as folding. Folding, okay? You take a piece of paper, you put it in the right folds and so forth, and you can make a paper airplane that will go from the top of Milam Auditorium right down here. There was a great YouTube video I saw this summer that somebody did one of these in a football stadium. Has anybody seen the video that I'm talking about? It goes all, they have a video of this, and this person throws it from like the very top of the football stadium, and it goes all the way down and hits somebody on the field. It was kind of cool, okay? Folding gave that piece of paper the property that it had, which was that it could fly. You fold that paper properly, and it's going to have a function, that function being, in this case, flying. You fold a protein properly, and the protein will have the property that we normally associate with it. If that's an enzyme, it might be catalyzing a reaction. If that is structural, it might be giving the cell stability. If that's fibrous, it might be giving rise to things like hair and fingernails and things like that. That property that we associate with that protein happens only if that protein folds properly. Okay? Well, we will see that there's many things that affect protein folding, and we don't even know all of them, surprising as that might seem. But one of the things we do know that affects a protein's folding is this entropy-driven process here. Entropy referring to chaos, and chaos referring to mixed upness. Nonpolar molecules, when you put them in water, you take it and you shake it up, right? You shake up the salad dressing so that you see these little tiny circles of the oil that gets sort of enmeshed in the water, right? That's what this is on the left. barely see it myself. By the way, tomorrow I will show you how to visualize my pointers on the screen. Okay? People say, well, I watch the YouTube videos and I can't see the pointer. Well, there's a way to do it, but I'll show you tomorrow when I have a YouTube, or not tomorrow, but Wednesday when I have a YouTube video to show you. Okay? How you can see those on the screen. All right, so here's a nonpolar molecule in water. It turns out that water doesn't like the nonpolar molecule, and the nonpolar molecule doesn't like water. So water arranges itself kind of like that person. Let's say, imagine you're at a party, and there's this person there who has, let's say, bad body odor. Okay? And that's no fun to be around, but maybe they're a popular person, and ooh, right? Okay? What are you going to do around that person at the party? Well, there's a safe distance at which you're not overwhelmed, right? But this is a popular person, so you want to talk to them, right? But you got this safe distance. So what's going to happen at a party is all of you are going to arrange yourselves a safe distance away from that person with the body odor. You're all going to be equally spaced. That's what we see right here. These guys have arranged themselves around that body odor right here. Okay? That's very ordered. It's very organized. That's anti-entropic. It's the opposite of entropy. So what drives these oil droplets to come together, as we see on the right, and I can't even see my own pointer there, what drives these oil droplets to come together is the fact that where they join, they have kicked water out. There's no water in here. They've kicked it out, and that allowed for more entropy. They increase entropy by the oil droplets joining together. And when the oil droplets join together, that's how we get a layer of oil and a layer of water. Now, why do I tell you about oil and water? I tell you that because proteins have parts of them that don't like water. And what will they do? They will fold so that those parts that don't like water interact with each other and don't interact with water. Pretty cool. Okay? Advanced protein chemistry day one. Boy, you guys are going to be so good. Okay? Protein folding, as I said, is essential for protein function. Proteins that fold properly have the proper function and do the right thing. Proteins that fold improperly can cause major problems. We'll talk about mad cow soon. Mad cow disease arises from a protein that doesn't fold properly. Okay? What determines how a protein folds? Ultimately, it's the sequence of amino acids that are in that protein. Each protein has its own unique sequence of amino acids. Each protein, therefore, has its own unique three-dimensional shape arising from folding. The sequence of amino acids, therefore, determines the folding. Okay, now, that's way too big. All right, now, let's move on to solutions. I've been talking about all this stuff. I haven't really said much about water. Let's talk about water. In freshman chemistry, everybody learns, impractically, pH is the negative log of the hydrogen ion concentration. And they impractically calculated pH by punching a number into a calculator. Okay? And it gave you an answer, and the professor said, yes, you have the right answer, and you are therefore a chemistry scholar as a result of that. Now, to me, that's not exactly a scholar. A scholar is somebody who has deep understanding of something. So what I aim for and what I'm telling you in practical knowledge is a deeper understanding than this first thing right here, that the pH is the negative log of the hydrogen ion concentration. You're going to want to use this equation for everything that you do, and you're going to be completely wrong in about 95% of the cases. Okay? The practicality is knowing when to use it and when not to use it. Okay? Now, conversely, the pOH is the negative log of the hydroxide ion concentration. pH plus pOH is 14. That's something you learn in freshman chemistry. Okay. In biochemistry, this, in fact, by the way, this equation works really well for strong acids and strong bases. HCl is a strong acid. What is something that's a strong acid? It completely dissociates in water. If I start out with 1 million molecules of HCl and I put it in water, I will get 1 million protons and 1 million chloride ions. That's complete dissociation. Okay? If I put 1 million molecules of NaOH in water, which is a strong base, I'll get 1 million sodium ions and 1 million hydroxide ions. Complete dissociation indicates the strength. Strong base completely dissociates. When you hear that term strong, that's what you should associate with it, complete dissociation. Acids in biochemistry are not strong for the most part. They're weak. And their weakness is their strength, conversely enough. Okay? Because they are weak, they can act to resist changes in pH. We can't use HCl to resist a change in pH. But we can use acetic acid to resist a change in pH. Okay? For weak acids, we have to think of something called the dissociation constant for an acid. That's the Ka part of the pKa. The dissociation constant for an acid is basically given right here. Concentration of protons times the concentration of, in this case, acetate for acetic acid, divided by the concentration of undissociated HAC. Where did that come from? That came from this equation right here. Acetic acid, HAC, and if I were to write this in general terms, I could just write HA, where HA refers to any weak acid, is in equilibrium with protons, and in this case, acetate. Okay. I put 1 million ions of HCl into water. I get 1 million, I'm sorry, 1 million molecules of HCl into water. I get 1 million ions of protons and 1 million ions of chloride. I put 1 million molecules of acetic acid into water, and I'm going to be lucky to get 1,000 of them go into protons. Weak acids are not strong. They don't completely come apart. The amount that they come apart can be changed. It depends on the pH of the solution into which I put them. If I put them in pure water, it's pretty easy to predict. If I put them into a solution that has a pH of, let's say, 4.1, it's going to be different than if I put it into pure water. The amount of dissociation is going to be a function of the pH that the acetic acid is in. And this is true for any weak acid. Now, by extension, many of you are thinking, well, the same is true for weak bases. And the answer is true. But I don't use the term weak base. And the reason I don't use the term weak base is because it confuses students. Okay? It confuses students. We will talk in this class about weak acids, and we will talk about what I call salts. Okay? The only time we will use the term base, isn't we're talking about a strong base. Okay? You may have to correct me on a couple of occasions, but that's one of the rules that I have. All right? Here's the dissociation. I told you it doesn't completely dissociate. The acid dissociation constant, the Ka, is a measure of how strong that weak base is, that weak acid is. Can't get base out of my head, all right? The Ka is a measure of how strong that weak acid is. Well, what does that mean, all right? What does the strength of a weak acid refer to? Well, let's imagine I have two weak acids. I've got acetic acid and I've got formic acid. Okay? Formic acid tends to dissociate more than acetic acid does at the same pH. That would be something that was a stronger weak acid. It's still a weak acid. It doesn't completely come apart, but more of it comes apart. So if I have an acid that has 1,000 molecules that come apart into protons, and I have another one that has 10,000 of those million that come apart into protons. The one that has 10,000 coming apart would be a stronger weak acid. It's not a strong acid, but it's a stronger weak acid. All right, now that I've got everybody kind of going, God, this is really a semantic thing here, right? We have to think about measures of those, okay? Well, just like the pH is the negative log of the hydrogen ion concentration, and the pOH is the negative log of the hydroxide ion concentration, so too is the pKa the negative log of the Ka. I'll give you a rule. You can memorize it if you want, or you can figure it out yourself, okay? The rule is this. The lower the pKa of a weak acid, the stronger the weak acid. Something that has a pKa of 4.76 is going to be a weaker weak acid than something that has a pKa of 2.76. You with me? Slow down, Ahern. Slow down. Questions? Yes? We don't talk about a pKa for a strong acid. Strong acids completely dissociate, and actually I'm exaggerating a little bit, but if they completely dissociate, this equation doesn't make any sense. So therefore, we don't talk about a pKa for a strong acid. And we will treat strong acids in this class as if they do, in fact, completely dissociate. Good question. Other questions? I don't bite. If I do, I've had my shots anyway. Yes? There you are. Okay, so if we have two weak acids and we compare their pKas, the one that has the lowest pKa will be the stronger of the two. So something that has a pKa of 2 is a stronger weak acid than something that has a pKa of 3. Okay? All right. Now, the reason I'm building up to all this is it's going to be important for you to be able to use equations to help tell you the charge on a molecule. Okay? So let's say proteins, which are really critical, their folding is really critical for their function, right? Proteins are full of weak acids and salts. They're full of them. Well, when a weak acid loses its proton, what happens to it? It gains a charge, right? It goes from 0 to minus 1. A salt can gain a proton. It starts out at 0, but if it gains a proton, it's going to have a charge of plus 1. The salts I'm talking about here are amines that we see inside of proteins. Well, let's imagine I have a protein. It's very nicely folded, and that protein is partly being held together by the fact that there's this amine over here that has a charge of plus 1, and there's this carboxyl group over here that has a charge of minus 1. Plus 1 and minus 1 interact with each other, and there's a force. There's an attraction for the two of them, and they help to hold that protein together. If I add just a little bit of acid, strong acid, to that solution, and I change it so that now the carboxyl, which had a charge of minus 1, gains a proton, it's gone from minus 1 to 0. Now here's this plus charge over here, and here's this 0 charge over here. Do you see any reason that they're going to be attracted to each other? They're not. You've just destabilized the protein. Being able to predict the charge of groups within a protein, very important to understanding the forces that hold together a protein. And we'll do some examples of that in the recitations. And I've got some problem-solving videos online. And if you come visit with me, I will also lead you through it. Okay? All right. Now, what I'm leading up to is a way to predict. Okay? It's something called the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. How many people have heard of the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation? Oh, very good. The Henderson-Hasselbalch equation is an equation that is extraordinarily useful for weak acid systems. And most of the systems that we work with in biochemistry are weak acid systems. It tells us that there's a relationship. Notice I said it was a relationship. You thought about it as an equation. An equation simply describes a relationship. Okay? There's a relationship between the pH of a solution, the pKa of the weak acid that's in that solution, and the ratio of the salt, which is this guy, and the acid, which is this guy. Okay. Now, how can I tell a salt from an acid in a weak acid system? It's very easy. The acid will always be the one that has the most protons. There, HAC is the acid. The thing that has lost the proton is the salt. Now, this relationship between pH, pKa, and salt and acid, we're going to come back to over and over and over again. It's a simple equation. Okay? It's a simple equation. Let's imagine, if you will, that I know that the pH of a solution is 4. Let's imagine that the pKa of the weak acid that's in that system is 5. And I say to you, is there more AC minus or more HAC in this solution? Well, the first thing you're going to do is you're going to pull out your calculator, which I'm not going to give you. Okay? And you're going to have to know how to do that. Well, it's very simple. If I solve for that equation, I take the 5 to this side, it means minus 1 is equal to the log of salt over acid. Logs that give negative numbers, they give those negative numbers when the ratio inside them is less than 1. Which one do I have more of? Nobody wants to venture a guess on that?
The acid,
right? Because if this ratio is less than 1, that means I've got to have more of this than I do this. Therefore, I have more acid. Make sense? Practical. Now, it's one example. We're going to go through other examples and talk about that. But before we go through that, I thought we would finish the day with a song. Yeah. One of the rules I have in this class is students like extra credit. Do you guys like extra credit? On exams, if you want extra credit, the way you get it is by singing loudly when we sing. I want to hear you sing. Henderson Hasselbalch, you put my brain in shock. Oh, woe is me. The pKa's can make me lie in bed awake. They give me really bad headaches. Oh, hear my plea. Salt-acid ratios help keep the pH froze by buffering. They show tenacity, complete audacity, if used with incapacity to maintain things. I know when H's fly, a buffer will defy them actively. Those protons cannot waltz when they get bound to salts. With this, the change in pH halts. All praise to thee. Thus, now that I've addressed this topic for the test, I've got know-how. The pH, I can say, equals the pKa. In some with log of S or A, I know it now. All right.